150 years ago and more, in this very church, Johann Sebastian Bach created and performed music that lives to this very day, joyous and fresh, as if time had never been. The Joy of Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach, 1685 to 1750. My name is Brian Blessed, actor, and I happen to like Bach very much. Today, he can still kindle a special excitement, pro and con. Yet I feel there's enough for everybody to choose, each his or her own Johann Sebastian. Some like him big. Some like him small. Just when you think you've got him pegged, he turns around and shows you a different face. Obviously, we can't show you all the faces. Just a sampler, the merest nibble of the musical feast. We can only pose one question. Why? Why this Bach revolution? How can he come across the centuries with such gusto? How can this man, from a time of marble and brass and wigs and faith, certainty in the Creator, still come through to us in this age of plastics and programming and the inexorable grip of a mechanistic universe? Singing as if God dictated to him, still lifting spirits and raising hackles, and in so many different ways. A joyful revolution indeed, when more of us can hear the master's voice at one time than all the people who ever heard all his music in all his life. What made the revolution? For one thing, electronic technology. Instruments the old boy never dreamed of. Still, it took more than hardware to make the revolution. It took people, and not just inventors, but interpreters, grace with the gift to communicate what they felt about this man's music. Pathfinders like Schweitzer, who searched out the secrets of Bach's own style. Pioneers like von der Landowska, who rescued the harpsichord from the museum and brought its voice back to life. Innovators like Stokowski. He may have set the ears of purists on edge, but he won millions of listeners to his new sound for sacrosanct old Bach. Masters like Pablo Casals, who reveal Bach's soul on the cello, touching the hearts of millions.
Bach is my best friend. He is the god of music.
And carrying on the great tradition, Rosalind Turek delights in spanning the centuries by demonstrating that Bach's music is well-tempered for every keyboard, from the old to the new. A most unlikely combination, isn't it?
Bach?
And synthetic sound? What do you suppose he would have said about the Moog?
He would have said the same thing that he said about the organ, a kind of synthesizer of his time.
What did he say?
Wonderful, he said. All you have to do is hit the right notes at the right time, and the music plays itself.
This is a prelude to the chorale, I Call Upon Thee. Like most of Bach's organ music, it was likely composed in Weimar, and maybe even right here. The Weimar County Judge's place of detention, jail. The sentence, 30 days. The crime, disrespect to His Serene Highness the Duke of Weimar, Bach's master. Accepting an appointment from a neighboring prince without first asking or getting permission from the Duke to change jobs. For in those days, a musician, even if his name was Bach, was just another hired hand, and the ruler was the law. Curiously enough, Bach wasn't all that famous in his own day as a composer. The organ was the king of instruments, and Bach was the acknowledged prince of players. What's more, he knew so much about the instrument itself, he used to moonlight from his regular jobs, called upon to test newly installed organs, from pedal to pipe, before they could be approved. It is a matter of record that Bach was often at odds with the organ builders, including Gottfried Silbermann, the most famous organ builder of his time.
Well, Herr Bach, what do you think?
Your principal base should have its own wind chest.
Herr Bock, if you'd and only realize...
And on several stops, the metal.
But the money we've had was insufficient.
Gentlemen, you have tried to save money on tin, but cheap is dear. In short, and in the interest of truth and proper sound, until you remedy this, I cannot approve this organ. But to me, the organ, Herr Silbermann, music is my only voice. But the organ is my pulpit.
And building them is my life.
No.
Let us hear the love. Been a little hasty.
How many times have I heard that before?
We'll give it another chance. Let's test the action.
Flamenco style, castanets no less, to complicated contrapuntal cerebral old Bach. By all means, Duns. You see, in his day, a musician could earn his bread and beer in mainly two places, the church or the court. And between the two, Bach swung.
As the court composer to Prince Leopold of Curten, Bach cheerfully churned out what he called delights for the spirit, music for dancing, minuets, gavottes, sarabands, bourrées, jigs, allemands, passe-pieds. The secret's out. We can do almost anything to Bach, except treat him like some museum piece under glass, and never violate his incredible energy. Thank you.
Above all, it is his music for the church that speaks the essential Bach. Not that he drew any distinction between religious and secular. All music was to glorify his Lord. He left us graphic evidence. Many manuscripts survive with two curious sets of initials in Bach's hand. At the beginning, J.J., from the Latin, Jesus help me. And at the close, S.D.G., Soli Deo Gloria, to the glory of God alone. His was a lifelong festival of faith, and the divine spark of his genius blazed to its fullest when he became cantor of St. Thomas in Leipzig.
With added duties as Latin teacher, choir master, task master, no easy job for a perfectionist like Johann Sebastian.
Is not good enough. If you were singing for me, fine. But you are not singing for me. Don't you listen to the words? Letters with voices united adore him. And speaking of united, Meissner, Hillmeyer, and you too, Hauptmann, always a quaver behind the beat. Well, you stay here until you can count if it takes all day. Hush for you, Knauser.
Out.
And you can tell your uncle, the town councillor, I said so. A musician you're not. And never will be. Go.
Herr Bach, when are you going to stop complaining and show proper obedience and respect to this honorable council? As for the way you treat your pupils, who authorized you to expel my nephew, Gottfried Krauser, from the choir?
Who appointed that incompetent without consulting me?
Why don't you come to meals and prayers at the school? Do you call that setting a good example for the boys?
Why didn't you conduct at the Krogels' wedding service? Too busy with your extracurricular music making at Zimmermann's coffee house?
Herr Bach, you do not conduct yourself properly.
What is going on in the town council is not an invention. Your most obedient servant. Time and time again, one tedious detail after another. The evidence is on record, verbatim, from the council minutes. It was a 20-year running battle with the establishment. They couldn't stare at each other's hair. Wigs. The fact is that Bach wasn't their first choice as cantor. When the council signed him on, they settled for what the record calls a mediocrity. The truth is that this man, hired to turn out music like a shoemaker, to fit countless church services year after year, this third string substitute became for Leipzig what Shakespeare was for Stratford, Michelangelo for Rome, a man for all time. Everywhere himself, the instrument of his faith. From here, Leipzig, the most incredible outpouring of music for the church the world has known. Over 300 cantatas, 59 in 1 year, 400 chorales, 20 pages of music a day, every day, for his 65 years. Still, despite the burden and the bureaucrats, he found time to write for his musical family. To be a loving husband and father. It was quite a family, for Bach was married twice. Of a total of 20 children, only 9 outlived their father. He used to boast of his young wife's good, clear soprano. A simple love song for Anna Magdalena's songbook. Joy transformed into sound, melody after melody, flowing from little Leipzig through time and space. These are the joys. In his studio at Highgate near London, for Yehudi Menuhin, the voice of his Stradivarius. Thank you.
or the Canadian Brass, a concert spreading joy in a shopping center in Toronto. For the animator, the interplay of color and form in visual counterpoint. Larry Adler, the enchantment of children in a Manhattan school, with an instrument he helped to make popular. Of the controversial Centre Pompidou in Paris, the energy of André Benichou's own version of Bach's Beat. Jean-Pierre Rampal, atop the Centre, the silver sound of his flute flying over the rooftops of the city. Karl Suska and his colleagues, the perfect unison of a concert in the old Berlin Museum on Unter den Linden. Christopher Parkening, the rapture of retreat to his Montana streams and mountains. The Brooklyn Boys Chorus, singing the original text, pure delight in the music's unquenchable vigor.
Thank you.
such are the joys. At a reception at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. Most of his life, Bach sought recognition. Finally, in the evening of his years, it came. Summoned to the court of Frederick the Great in Potsdam. Never to know that soon he would be gone, obscurity to follow, his music forgotten. Never to know his Anna Magdalena to become a pauper, his very manuscripts peddled by his children. Some to be used to wrap cheese, some bound around trees, smeared with tar against insects.
Your Royal Highness, from Leipzig, the Kapellmeister.
Ah, old Bach is here.
Frederick was no mean musician himself, and Bach's son, Carl Philipp Emanuel, was in his service.
Your Royal Highness, my father.
It is good of you to come. We have a favor to ask of you, Herr Kapellmeister. We have just acquired a new instrument, Herr Bach.
Mm-hmm. A Silbermann, I see.
For a long time, we have heard of your skill at improvisation. Yes, and so, you will execute a fugue on this theme.
Bach would be blind. Another year after that, while dictating a chorale, in mid-melody, he would die. Of all the composers who have sung to their fellow mortals, few have equaled Bach in the creation of music as an act of worship. Let him now speak for himself in praise of his God, in giving thanks for the gift of his son, and in rejoicing in his resurrection. Generation upon generation have responded to Bach, each finding in him something new. How long, do we dare wonder, will this joyous discovery go on? Well, not long ago, men of our time implanted into a spacecraft named Voyager 2 a recording. First, on that disc, fashioned of copper and gold to last a billion years, was Bach. Thousand years from now, beyond our universe, Voyager 2 will roam among the galaxies for hundreds of millions of years, carrying this calling card from the human race. There may be life out there. If there is, and if by some miracle those creatures can decipher the directions for playing that record, they will hear what you are hearing now. Long after we, and perhaps our planet, are dust, other life may hear its exuberance and joy. This creation of a man whose own life was encompassed within 200 square miles, who sings now, and into all eternity. Thank you.